Hey everyone, so today I'm doing an unboxing and first look impression of the Raspberry Pi Model 4B. I'm really excited to open this. This is the first model that Raspberry Pi as a company is marketing towards regular consumers as a desktop computer, a low-cost desktop computer, which is what I find really exciting about this. It's no longer just a cheap PC for DIY projects, but you can do your, you know, your email, your business, your social media, all on this ultra-cheap computer, and it even comes as a kit. Now, there's a really low entry cost to owning a desktop computer, which has extraordinary benefits if you think about just emerging markets or developing countries. You know, it's much cheaper now to have a computer, and a very capable computer at that. So this leads to the most important question, which is which Raspberry Pi Model 4 should you purchase, or what kit or package? And to be honest, that really depends on how many spare computer parts you have lying around. So the cheapest Raspberry Pi you can purchase is £35 for the 1 GB board. And then on the high-end side for £55 is the 4 GB model version, which Raspberry Pi is positioning for those who want to use this as a computer. The side of the box shows everything that's included. It includes the 4 GB Pi model, your keyboard, a really nice mouse. It also comes obviously with the memory card, your USB-C power supply, two micro HDMI cables, which is really cool. So they want you to connect this to two displays if you have two displays lying around. Obviously a case and the book. So let's go ahead and open this. You immediately see everything that's inside the box that you need. Your power supply, the Raspberry Pi, mouse, and I suppose underneath the keyboard and the book. It looks like there's some feet for your Raspberry Pi, which is really nice. And then inside you have the board connected to the bottom of the case. This is your little power supply, really nice. And this is the wired mouse. And then what you have here is the memory card. We lift off this small little section. These are our two micro HDMI cables. Again, very nice that they include this, because micro HDMI is not the best standard in the sense that we don't have many micro HDMI cables laying around. Even if you're a tech enthusiast, it's just not a cable that we tend to own. This is your full-size keyboard. I actually really like it. I like the color. This is your book. So again, it's so consumer friendly, because you know, if you're just a regular person who doesn't know much about computers, you know, it even comes with some really nice reading material to get you started. So the big changes from the Model 3 is that you now have gigabit Ethernet. So this will actually make a really good file server if you have a lot of hard drives laying around that you want the entire network in your house or office to connect to. You could actually have a really nice file server. You have two USB 3 ports for your hard drives, for example, if you were to use it as a file server, but just really nice for transferring files. USB 3 is so much faster than USB 2. Then you have your two USB 2 ports. Definitely use this for the keyboard and mouse, because you know, these are like legacy ports. On your side, you have your headphone. So this port's really interesting, because this can do video out, like the old-fashioned composite video, like back in the early 2000s, before high definition, before HDMI. But this is really important, in my opinion, for not just the education market that have, you know, older technology due to lack of funds and resources, but also emerging markets and developing countries that perhaps don't have, you know, new televisions or computer screens. They can still buy this and hook it up to their regular computer screen or old television and still get a computer working on that composite video port. Here are your two micro HDMIs, and then this is actually your USB-C power supply. I would have gotten rid of these two USB 2 ports and just put two USB-Cs, because while this can be used for power, from what I'm aware of, you cannot use it for hard drives or transferring, you know, files or anything. These are also just your enthusiast connectors for cameras or GPIO pins. These stay the same for backwards compatibility with your Raspberry Pi devices. This is your mouse. Again, what I really like about it is it actually has quite a short wire, so that's what makes it really convenient to plug it into the keyboard. This is the matching keyboard. This is actually extremely cute. So this is the keyboard. As you can see, this is your little USB hub at the back for your mouse and other small peripherals. So I've been testing the Raspberry Pi 4 for a few days now, and my first impressions review of the device is that as a desktop computer,
it's a mixed bag, and let me explain why. Firstly, with some good news, as you can see, this is my Raspberry Pi 4 here, and I kitted it out with a Bluetooth mouse and keyboard. This is my multi-device keyboard and mouse I showed in my previous setup video, and it was actually a little bit tricky to set up with the Raspberry Pi 4, but it wasn't because of the hardware, it's just the Bluetooth manager that's built into Raspbian OS was just being difficult. Using Terminal, I downloaded Bluez-Blueman manager, and that was much better than the built-in Bluetooth manager that comes with Raspbian OS. And overall, that's almost the theme of this video, which is actually not about the hardware. I actually think the problem with Raspberry Pi 4 as a desktop computer is the software. As you can see, the Raspberry Pi 4 is also connected to my 4K monitor, and it can do 3840 by 2160. However, it's important to note that that's 30 Hertz. It's not 60 Hertz, the full refresh rate. And another issue is that Raspbian OS doesn't support a high DPI like macro Windows. So everything is, you know, scaled down, it's 1:1. So I wouldn't really recommend using it at 4K resolution unless you plan to hook it up to your television as a media center to drive 4K content. Then I think it would work great. But as for a desktop computer, you're gonna have to run it at 1920 by 1080, as you can see, your full 1080p. And you know, in fairness, this is also a budget computer. So if you were to plug it into a monitor, it's probably gonna be a budget monitor. And they typically tend to be, you know, 1080p or 720p. So the Raspberry Pi 4 has no issue powering one or two of them. You know, it'll do that absolutely perfectly. But if you have some 4K monitor ambitions, it is worth pointing out. I'm also happy to report that the Raspberry Pi mostly does everything a regular computer user would want. I was able to use social media websites and email, Google Maps, and read news websites. For office productivity software, Google Docs and Office Online ran fine, but of course you're going to get more optimal performance from LibreOffice. But in fairness, most computer users will probably want to use Google Docs and Office Online for the collaboration features. This brings us to content consumption, which is where the Raspberry Pi 4 stumbles. So I don't understand why with 4GB of RAM and a quad-core processor that's 3 times faster than Raspberry Pi 3, why YouTube videos cannot play. It's actually a bit shocking, to be honest with you. No performance difference between like going from between 1080p or, you know, standard definition, which really leads me to believe that we're dealing with a software issue here and not a hardware issue. I also wasn't able to get Netflix working on the Raspberry Pi 4, which is kind of an issue, and I even watched several YouTube tutorials trying to figure it out, and if I couldn't get it working, then a mass market, a general computer user, certainly won't be able to get it working. Another thing to note is that the Raspberry Pi 4 definitely gets hot. I also have a friend who owns a Raspberry Pi 4, and they kind of basically traded notes, and we all came to the same conclusion that this thing really overheats. Now, Raspberry Pi 4 is going to issue a firmware update. It's actually already available on their website, but my device hasn't received it automatically. So, you know, if I can't receive firmware updates easily, then how, again, do you expect a regular computer user to install a firmware update? Another thing to note is that I actually had issues using the Raspberry Pi App Store. It keeps crashing, and I don't know what's causing that either. So I think the issue here is the software. I don't think this can sell well in retail shops. I think you're going to see a lot of people returning their devices if it can't play YouTube, if it can't do Netflix. I mean, these are regular content consumption things, and YouTube and Netflix are like two of the most popular video platforms. I obviously understand it can drive 4K video playback using VLC. Raspberry Pi needs to work with YouTube, they need to work with Netflix and figure out what's causing it and how they can fix it. I know a lot of that sounded negative, but I think the best way to sell this would be Raspberry Pi 4 desktop kit with a subtitle, and that's for enthusiasts, because I just don't think this computer is just there yet for mainstream users. It just isn't. I think maybe Raspberry Pi should have waited until version 5 to give them some more time to, you know, refine the software. And that being said, I think one area the Raspberry Pi 4 desktop kit could sell pretty well is, again, emerging markets, developing countries, and countries with high import tariffs, which I mentioned in another video. And that's because the cost of entry to owning a desktop computer is now substantially lower. You know, they can still do productivity, run a business, you know, social media, they can still do all of that on the Raspberry Pi 4. So there could be still a lot of value to be had here for them. So that's my first impressions Raspberry Pi 4 review. I hope you enjoyed the unboxing and the first look. If you want to see more Raspberry Pi videos, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel so I can see the analytics and know it's because you watched this Raspberry Pi video and want to see more. Anyway, let's keep an eye on this. I think it's a developing situation. I think, you know, let's see if they refine Raspbian OS. You know, if they refine the software, I'll definitely do another review and let's see if they can iron out some of these bugs. Anyway, I'm Lee-Loi. Thanks for watching.